Since NASA launched the Hubble telescope in the 1970s, we've been blessed with some pretty spectacular images from space, from constellations to galaxies to black holes and beyond. But is what we're seeing actually real? Because we've definitely been tricked before. You may remember last month when a French scientist tweeted out this picture of what he said was a newly discovered star that turned out to be a piece of chorizo. The scientist quickly admitted to the spicy prank in a series of follow-up tweets, but the tweet still has more than 20,000 likes. He later posted this stunning image of the Cartwheel Galaxy taken by the James Webb Space Telescope, insisting it was a real image. But even supposedly real photos like these are heavily manipulated before we ever get to see them. So how real or fake are photos from deep space? This photo of the Cartwheel Galaxy actually started off as this. It's a black and white image full of data that scientists translate into colors to give us these stunning images. For instance, take a look at this dramatic image called Cosmic Cliffs, taken of the Carina Nebula from the James Webb Space Telescope. It turns out this picture actually started off as this grayscale image. Not nearly as beautiful, but also pretty incomprehensible, right?
Are the images fake? I would definitely not call them fake. This is really what the Southern Ring Nebula looks like. However, the colors are enhanced.
That's astrophysicist Matt O'Dowd, a professor at Lehman College and host of the PBS YouTube series Space Time.
So this image in particular, it's infrared light, which is the sort of light that the James Webb Space Telescope sees, is beyond the range that humans are perceptible to. If we were to publish this image in the infrared, we wouldn't see anything. So first up, we got to translate it to something that we can see.
Let's back up a bit and talk about colors, specifically how we humans see them. Think of the electromagnetic spectrum as all of the light that exists in our universe. The tiny portion of it that we as humans can see is called visible light, with the highest frequency wavelengths appearing as red and the lowest frequency wavelengths appearing as purple. When light bounces off an object and into our line of sight, the rods and cones of our eyes translate those light waves into colors. Just the same way, telescopes can also see different wavelengths of light, but today's telescopes can see a much broader range of electromagnetic waves than what is visible to us.
Some of the most beautiful colors come from just this gigantic clouds of gas that live between the stars that are, in fact, in the process of forming stars, collapsing under their own gravity. But that gas emits very particular wavelengths of light, and those wavelengths of light, which correspond to particular colors of light, are the signatures of the type of atoms, okay? So there'll be oxygen, there'll be hydrogen, there'll be carbon, there'll be all these different elements on the periodic table, and each one of those shines with certain specific colors. What that means is that the image that you see is actually scientifically instructive. So you'll see these beautiful oranges and yellows and blues and purples, but they all really correspond to very real differences in wavelength in the infrared image as it was taken by the Webb.
Through these images of clouds and dust, scientists can create a colorized map to show the different phases of star formation. One of the more striking images is this one called the Pillars of Creation, and we've seen that on the NASA website. It looks stunning. Now compare that to the black and white image. The black and white image is pretty stunning to me too, but I wonder a little bit about what it is that we're seeing.
So first up, this is closer to reality. You know, we could travel to the Eagle Nebula, which is where the Pillars of Creation are, and we could find a position where we would essentially see this. Okay, these are visible light colors, and the colors chosen when developing this image correspond approximately to the colors that our eyes interpret when we catch that wavelength of light. However, it wouldn't pop quite this much, I think. So again, some liberty is taken in exactly how blue the blues are and how red the reds are.
Now, this isn't exactly disinformation, but if you are trying to help explain something and you're trying to accentuate some of the colors, well, it's It's not the raw images, it's not the raw data.
Sure, this is not what our eye would see, and it's not what initially recorded by the telescope. These color images tend to be made up of multiple images of the same object, each image sensitive to a slightly different wavelength range. But each of those images separately, you know, kind of looks black and white. Okay, there's no color information in each separate image, it only comes when you combine the image. But in a way, the color image that our brains perceive only occurs in the last step of our processing of this image, which is to say in the brain itself. It's only in the brain that this gets reassembled and, you know, this subjective experience of color comes into it anyway. So I feel like, you know, it's all fake till it hits your brain. And it certainly keep the colors separate, or we can put them together, you know, sooner or later. The astronomers just do it in the most efficient way possible.
So NASA is really doing with these images kind of what our brain does when light comes into our eyeballs?
Yeah, I like to think of it that way. Enhanced a little bit. That, you know, essentially NASA is trying to give us some super color sensitivity.
You know, I'm going to ask you about chorizo gate, and I'm wondering, do you think it's a net positive? Was it bad for the field? Did it get more people interested? Is all press good press?
I have to say I laughed. I think you can get away with a lot when it's just funny. The question I would ask with chorizo gate, in which an astronomer published a nice spicy chorizo slice on Twitter and told us that this was Proxima Centauri, you know, was there any misinformation here that, you know, caused harm to how people understand the universe, or sensationalized something in a way that harmed people's ability to consume science in the future? You know, I think if it wasn't very quickly admitted that it was a joke, then maybe it could have been harmful, because people would stop trusting such things. It was admitted as a joke extremely quickly. I think it's any harm is pretty subtle, but it certainly got some good laughs.
According to Matt, it's not the scientists we need to watch out for, but those out there capitalizing on what he calls the mystification of science.
People, I think, sometimes due to their own lack of education on the subject, but sometimes I think also a little maliciously, will misinterpret some of the incredible findings about the subatomic world and quantum physics to promote pseudoscience and mysticism. And remember that kind of meme video of the sun moving through the galaxy and the planets whirling around the sun and making this beautiful spiral behind the sun? And the caption is something like, you know, this is how we really move through space, okay? Everything that you've been shown of planets just moving in a circle around the sun is wrong. We move through this beautiful spiral, almost as though there's some mystical element to the nature of this. And while it's true that from a certain frame of reference, we do move in this spiral through space, it's actually not more correct than the standard view of us just moving around the sun.
So Matt, what's your tip for people who are casual surfers of the web, interested in space, they see a cool story, they see an amazing image? What is the tip that you'd have for people when they're consuming space information?
You can't get your holistic perspective on this universe by only consuming small snippets here and there. However, there are tons of resources for getting this slightly more complete view. PBS has Crash Course Astronomy, which is all 100% correct. So anything you read from NASA is going to be heavily vetted by scientists. The European Space Agency, also more reputable publications, the New York Times or The Guardian or anything that has its own reputation at stake, you can go to their science and they'll at least be pretty credible. And by reading this stuff, you start to get a sense for what sensationalized news sounds like. You very quickly train yourself. Okay, you might not know you're doing it, but things will start to sound fishy, I think, if you start to dig a little bit deeper.
So there you have it. Always check your space sources. And next time NASA releases an incredible color photo of the cosmos, don't forget the blend of science and art that goes into making that final image. Because when it comes to photos of deep space, much like the universe itself, we know there's a lot more than meets the eye. I'm Hari Srinivasan, and this is Take on Fake. Thanks for watching.